Welcome to episode 11 of the Craft House Magic Podcast. Thank you so much for joining me. Thank you for giving me a go, or coming back if you've seen me before. So we're on episode 11. How crazy is that? Episode 11. So it's Sunday the 12th of February, and it's a horrible, horrible, wet, sort of sludgy, partially snowy day outside. So we're having to rely on inside lights. You can see that this side is lighter than the window, which is crazy because it's like 10 past 12. I'm drinking some lovely new tea I bought from Wittard. I'll just show you the little jar. So it's loose leaf and it's apple and elderflower. It's really yummy, which is, this is helping me not eat lots of biscuits and cakes and things. Just a little bit of sweetness. And as you can see, my glass mug that Adam bought me for Christmas is still not broken. So I'm really chuffed about that. Anyway, on to the proper things. So, oh, I forgot to say, we've got 1,000 subscribers! Yeah! I cannot believe that you guys, so many of you guys are following me. It's absolutely brilliant. Thank you so much for following. And I will be doing a little giveaway on Instagram in the next week, so keep a lookout for that. In terms of Instagram, I'm Craft House Magic. You can also find me on Ravelry as Craft House Magic, and I have my own website, crafthousemagic.co.uk, with all the links to all the other social media, so you can find me there. My shop on Etsy is also called Craft House Magic, which I haven't updated very much recently. There's lots of stitch markers on there, but not so many bags as like normally, I can't speak, as I normally do, so I'm sorry about that. But what I will do is I'll have a shop update on the 1st of March of little bits and bobs that I've got together over the next few weeks. It's just been crazy with all this wedding things and all that. So I will have a shop update on the 1st of March, so keep an eye out. And one of the reasons for having the shop update on the 1st of March is that we've got the knit along for the sock challenge 2017, where I was challenging you guys to try out new patterns and things that you've not done before in terms of socks, and push you that little bit further rather than doing the same old sock pattern that you've always done. So there's a thread in our Ravelry group, Craft House Magic, and you can see all the discussion about all the different patterns that people have been doing. And today I'm going to open a Ravelry page or a Ravelry discussion forum, the finished objects. So please make sure you add your finished objects to the finished objects thread, because that will make you legible to win a prize. So I showed you on a couple of episodes ago that the lovely Ruth from Knitterarium has given us a pattern, well, like a pattern code that will allow you guys to pick one of her lovely shawl patterns that she's got out. She's got absolutely loads. And if you look a couple of episodes back, you'll be able to see some examples of those, or my favourites anyway. And I'm actually knitting one of her patterns now, so you can see that a bit later. We've also had a lovely surprise from Fondant Fibre. She sent us a little package to send us a little prize. So thank you so much, Deb. I'll show you that a little bit later. And lastly, I'm going to give a voucher for my Etsy shop so that you can have a bag set that I normally do. I normally do a knitting bag with a notions pouch and a DPN case inside with some stitch markers in there. So it'll be a voucher for one of those, but you can obviously choose which one you like then. And if you don't like any in the shop, just give me a message of some, an idea of something you will like, and I'll try and get something, some fabrics that you might be more interested in. But I've got a few new fabrics that I've purchased recently to make some bags with, so I'm hopefully you'll like some of those. So that's three lovely prizes for the sock knit along, or the sock challenge 2017. So don't forget to put your finished objects in the finished objects thread. So you'll only be allowed one entry, and it needs to be a finished object, so a whole pair of socks. That's two socks. I know that you'll know already. I don't know what I'm on about. So you'll have to have a finished pair of socks and just one entry. So I won't be commenting on, there'll be no, I don't want anybody adding loads of chatter in the finished objects thread, as per normal really. And I'll pick out a winner out of those and tell you on the next podcast. Actually, what I will do is I'll have a separate little video with the winner on the last day of February, so that I make sure that I get it on the last day of February rather than at the weekend. not very organised today. As you can tell, I'm on the edge of a little cold. I actually had a day off on Friday. It's just, it absolutely drains the life out of your colds. I hate them. I hate them so much. Although on the other hand, yesterday afternoon, all I did was sit and knit because you can't do much else but sit there when you're really, really drained. So it was a good excuse to get some knitting done. Sorry, little sip. So, I think that's all the administration done for today. And today we've got some knitting, some finished objects, some works in progress. We've got some sewing, which will be a bit of dressmaking today. I've got some confessions. some lovely little swaps that I've done with people. And a gadget, which is quite interesting. And I think that's it. I don't know if I'll be able to do Ask Me Anything questions because I can't seem to get on Ravelry. So it might be a case that I'll actually stick a bit on the end of the video that I'll record after Ravelry is up and running. If not, I'll have to do the questions in the next episode. I'm sorry about that. It must be something to do with Ravelry website because I've tried on my iPad, my laptop and my phone and I just can't get on. So we'll have to see if it starts to get up and running again before the end of the day. So, or the end of daylight, because I can't video this in the night time. It'd just be ridiculously dark. Right, so finished objects today. I finished my shawl. It's massive. So this is the Sugar Plum Shawl by Mina Philip. And I started this in about September. I just checked my Ravelry page yesterday when it was up and running. And it's got a lovely lacy bit just on the edge there. And you can see the lovely colours. So this is a Malabrigo sock in the Lotus colourway. And then there's some, like a garter stitch area with some little eyelet holes. So this is quite a big, it's about the length of my arms, the actual shawl. And I did the biggest size that it comes in. It took me about 150 grams of the Malabrigo sock to do the largest size. But I am a quite tight knitter. So you may well use a little bit more yarn than I did, but I really love this colour in it. It's actually a lot bigger than I anticipated it to be. I thought, oh, I better do the largest size. But I think it'd probably look a little bit more dainty if I'd have done the sort of small or medium. But I still like it, it's lovely. So I'll probably wear it something like this. My hair's still a bit wet, I washed it this morning. There we go. So that's nice and cosy. Lovely finished object. So I'm so glad I finished that because I've got too many shawls on the needles. I've got three shawls. Well, I did have three shawls. I've got two now. So two's a little bit more manageable and I actually get some work done on them rather than just spreading a little bit of work on one, a little bit of work on the other. So I'm glad I got this one off the needles, so it's lovely. I definitely use this yarn again. It seems to be quite soft but also relatively sturdy as well, so it'd be quite nice to knit some socks out of this as well because it's sock yarn. So on to my next finished object. I finished my sock blank socks. So they're completely different. So this is the one I showed you. I think I'd got about up to there on the last episode. And it's changed slightly, which is lovely. I especially like the way sock blanks go like this weird stripy pattern the most. So this is a hedgerow yarn sock blank. And it's a lovely merino with stellina in it, which is really, really pretty. I don't know if you can really see the sparkles. I haven't actually washed them and blocked them properly. They've just been on the sock blockers. But they look okay. They've been on the sock blockers for a few days. I don't know why I didn't wash them before. It's ridiculous. And then they'd have looked neater for you. So this is the second sock. And you can see it's got this lovely stripy texture. And I forgot to say, this is Mina Phillips vanilla sock pattern with a modified heel flap. And the lovely Terry had gifted me that pattern. Hi, Terry. So I finished the pair of socks, and I think that they do actually fit really well with this extra bit of a sort of mini heel flap, as well as the German short row heel. I like the way that Mina does her German short row heel. It's really nice and easy to follow, and once you've done it once, I think I could do it again without reading the pattern. It's really easy. So that's nice to be able to remember a pattern and not have to read it through again. Well, I think I can. It's probably best if I actually read the pattern again. So there we go. There's the two socks. They're really, really soft. And when I've tried them on, they feel so soft underfoot. I love James Hedgerow's yarn. It's lovely. So that's those finished. Beautiful. And I definitely do the Mina Phillips heel flap adjustment German short row heel pattern again. That was really lovely. So there we go. Now on to not finished objects. We've just done finished objects. And now doing works in progress. So in terms of socks, I've cast on another sock. And you might have seen a few episodes ago, I showed some yarn from Peggy May Yarns. And this, you can see how messily I've done this ball up. So this is Peggy May Yarns in her Frosty the Snowman colourway. That's so, so pretty. Lovely little bits of grey and blues in there. Really pretty. Really does seem very frosty. I'll show you the label for the yarn. That's Diane's card. She's Peggy May Yarns. Diane is the dyer behind it. And it's called Frosty the Snowman. It's 75% superwash merino, 25% nylon. And there's approximately 400 metres in 100 grams. I'm reading the forward slash as a one. That's just, it's impossible to have 1,400 metres in one, like a 100 gram skein. Well, for sock yarn it is anyway. Sorry, Diane. Terrible. Anyway, I need to show you these socks. So, I am knitting these on 2.25 millimetre needles, and these are my Knit Pro Zing double pointed ones. I thought I'd go back to those for a change. And the pattern, as you can see, is the Mercury socks, and you can see how lovely those little speckles of blue and grey are coming out. You can see on that side too. I'm really looking forward to seeing how these knit up. But I've done, how many rows have I done? 1, 2, 3, 4 repeats of the pattern so far. Mine really coming up nicely. So the Mercury socks is a free pattern on Ravelry, and if you haven't found it, you should go and download it straight away because it's lovely. What it does suggest that you do a German twisted cast on to start with, and I did actually cast on that way, but I got about halfway down the cuff and I didn't really like how it looked, so I undid it and did it in my normal long tail cast on way. I think that looked a little bit neater. And what's also interesting I found was, I think it's the Pink Perler on YouTube. I think that's correct. I'll put it down below here if I have got it incorrect. I'm sure that's correct though. She suggested that when you're doing, like, in terms of cables mainly, if you've got like a knit and then a purl that comes after each other, if you do your purl and then put your yarn to the back of the work and just give it a little tug, you end up with your stitches a little bit neater, and I think that worked a bit for me. They're still not 100% neat. I can never get them perfect in rib, but they do look better, I think, in terms of the way I knit. I don't know whether you think that works for you. Has anybody else tried that? It'd be interesting to see what you guys think. So that's that pair of socks. I might also in the next few days cast on just a very, very plain sock, so that when I'm out and about I can knit them, because even though these are very easy, if I'm sort of chatting away or having to stuff my needles into a bag very quickly, it might be easier if I've got a very, very plain stockinette sock. That's why I quite often have a nice plain sock that I can just pick up and not have to think about at all. Mind you, I must say that the actual eyelet pattern And the Mercury socks is very, very intuitive. And once you've done one repeat, I could remember the whole repeat again. It's just that sometimes you just want knitting that you don't have to think about at all. So that's project number one. Oops, sorry about the jingling. Project number two. So, I've stuck all the yarn on top of my work. That's no good, is it? I haven't done loads of work on this, but because I've been working on my sugar plum shawl. Let me see which way round it is. Oh, I'm not quite sure, but they both look quite pretty anyway. I'm hitting my cup of tea with my needles now. That's not good. That's not going to make the cup last very long, is it, in glass? So this is the gorgeous... Oh, there you go. You can see in the light there. You can see the pattern it's creating. So this is the G shawl, as I called it last episode. And Ruth did actually tell us all how to pronounce this, and I've completely forgotten. I will try and listen to your video again, Ruth, and make sure I remind myself how to say it. But otherwise, I'll call it the G shawl for today. So I finished one repeat of the pattern, and I think there's 16 repeats in total. So it's coming out about this wide, if you can see. And it's actually really, really nice to be knitting a sort of straight pattern that doesn't increase and increase and increase into infinity. Because I did find with my sugar plum shawl, by the end I was getting a bit fed up of the massive, massive rows. So to have a lovely little pattern that's just sort of the same length of stitches each time, it's just lovely. So that's just the right project for me now. So I'm going to focus on this one for the next week, I think, or the next episode. Hopefully get quite a bit done on that. I'm supposed to be finishing it by the end of February. I don't think I will, because Ruth at the Knitterarium is doing a knit along to do with the Year of You shawl knitting knit along. And the first section finishes in February, or the end of February, and I'm not quite sure whether I'll get it finished, but I'll really try my best. I just had to get one of my shawls off the needles and get the sugar plum shawl, because that was closest to finishing, so that I didn't feel quite so sort of stressed with lots of projects on. It's silly, really, because I don't mind having like a shawl, a pair of socks and a jumper and things, but it annoys me when I've got too many of the same thing. But hopefully I'll get loads of work done on that list the next sort of couple of weeks. So it's exciting. I am really enjoying that pattern, because actually you can read your knitting below what you're doing very, very easily. And it's so easy to sort of find where you are on the pattern if you haven't looked at it for a few days. One of my other works in progress is my Cozy Memories blanket. Ta-da! So I'd done up to here when I last showed you, and I've done this square. I'm showing you the back. This square, which is Hedgerow Yarns in her 50% merino, 50% silk, in a grey colourway. I can't remember what the actual colour was called, but it's in a lovely sort of grey colour. And this is the sock blank, some of the sock blank I've been knit for my socks. So I did a square in that too. So that's coming on along nicely. So what I do as I'm doing my decreases is that I've got a little stitch marker on the back where I know, because I've got a decrease on the back side, so when I get to that side I know that it's time to decrease. And this is one of the stitch markers. I've got some of these on my Etsy shop if you're interested in seeing those. There's some different other little butterflies as well, and a dragonfly. There we go. So we've got, look, we've nearly got a cowl going on there. Oh dear. So I can actually fold it now, which is a little bit better. And we're getting there slowly. So I'm still on my target of one every week. So I'm hoping at the end of the year there'll be 52 squares, even though that's not that many. I might up my game a bit later on. We'll see. I really need to focus on wedding dress things though, so we'll have to see about that. So I've been working on a wearable muslin for my wedding dress. So to start with, you're going to laugh at this fabric. So, oh, I better show you the pattern first. I don't know if you'll be able to see it through this plastic bag. So this is the pattern that I've chosen. And you can see it's got like a V-neck. This one has got a little capped sleeve that's made out of lace. And then a long skirt. There's two versions. You can have a straight one or one that's trailed slightly. So in an effort to sort of get the top part to fit and just to make sure that I could construct it quite easily, just have a little bit of a practice, I've decided to make a wearable muslin that's sort of short, just past the knee length, just to see how it looks. What I'm going to have to do, I think, is to have like a tulle underskirt under the short one, just to make it lay properly, because it's got like a sort of, the way it lays, you need something to hold it out, otherwise it looks a bit sort of floppy, if that makes sense. So to start with, I'll show you, actually, before I show you my scrappy bits, I'll show you the pattern pieces. So this, I don't know if you can see, the lighter grey section is where the original pattern piece was, and I photocopied this. And because this is quite a small piece, it's quite handy, it's easy to photocopy on one piece of A4. and what I've done is just added pieces with paper around the side, and you can see that I've increased it from here to here, because my boobs are a bit bigger than the pattern, which is really irritating, because I keep having to adjust all these patterns, it's a pain. So as you can see, I've just been adding little bits here and there each time that I've done it. This is another piece. I had to photocopy two sections and pin this together, and you can see that I've added quite a bit in the length of there to compensate for the amount that I've added around the bust area, because it has to fit. See, this is, I don't know if you can see properly, so this is the shoulder, this is the side of the bust, and because I've added a bit round here, it needs to have more material to go around the edge, so this needs to be elongated, so that'll fit just there. This looks a bit crazy, waving piece of paper. So the back of the pattern as well, I've actually merged two pieces together, and I've modified this strap, because it did actually start really close to the underarm, which really didn't look good on me, not good at all. So this is what I started with first. So I got some old curtain fabric and I made a sort of copy, once I've modified it as much as I thought I needed to, and I made a copy just to kind of fit on myself and see how I liked it. And you can see here how I've actually, if I unpin that, because I don't really need it anymore, I've got a thing about sticking pins in my mouth. It used to be sort of very close under the arm, about here, so I moved it out to where my bra strap is and put it there, and I thought, well, that's better, and then I modified the pattern accordingly. So once I'd done about four of these, using up my mum's old curtain fabric, hadn't been curtains, it was just left over from when she made me make her curtains, you see, I made a copy in, this is a taffeta material. So I made a copy in the taffeta material, and I actually lined it in taffeta as well for this particular version. It is very, very frayy, this material. So you can see it's got a similar front, but now, because I've got the lining inside, you can see how thinner the straps are. And I did notice that this is how thin the straps go at the very back, if you follow the pattern. So I changed my mind there, and I've actually adapted to them so that they're much thicker now. And hence, you can see, this is how I've adapted the pattern. This is how thin the strap was to start with. And then I actually just added paper either side, so it stayed the same width as the top of the pattern. So it's just a case of adding bits of paper, really. I do like to modify pattern pieces and make several muslins rather than trying to adapt pieces that I've already cut out of the real fabric. I would just get way too stressed. So those are the sort of scrap ones, and if you look on my Instagram page, you'll see a photograph of what I've made up so far of my sort of second taffeta version. at the top, and I've also cut the pieces out for the skirt and the lining and joined them all together, but I haven't attached them to the top of the body yet. I'm not going to show them you now. I can't speak. I'm not going to show them you now. There are photographs on my Instagram, and I will put more photographs on when I've done a little bit more work, just because it's on my dressmaking dummy and it really wouldn't fit right. And I don't really want to unpin it right now. So I'll take some more photographs as I'm working on it and give you an update in the next episode. So I think that's all. I don't know if there was any other things I wanted to say about my sewing. In terms of sort of making a shorter skirt, what I did is actually measure from the bottom of the pattern. So actually I took this pattern where it's a straight bottom, and I measured a certain distance, which I worked out from holding it up against myself, from the bottom of the skirt, and then I actually marked on the pattern and cut it so I could rejoin it when I want to do the longer version. So I think it's a good idea just to have a little practice for the fitting. I don't think there's going to be any problems with the sort of the shape of the whole length of the skirt. I'll have to shorten it, of course, because I'm not the tallest person in the world. But there we go. That's that. So I have a little section to do with the wedding at the very end, in case you don't want to listen to it. But I've now got a gadget that's related to sewing. So this is a little bit different than normal. So these are washers that I use. Now you might think, what the hell do you use these massive, great, big, heavy washers for? So I use these as pattern weights to cut out my pattern pieces. They're really, really heavy washers that I don't know what they use them for, some type of engineering job, but I got these from eBay. Now they're large M24 washers that I got from eBay. It's difficult to know which sort of size to order, but if you have large M24 washers, they'll be able to, you know, they'll be nice and big and heavy to hold the pattern pieces down. I like these because they're nice and thin and they don't sort of get in your way as you're cutting around the pattern pieces. So I use a rotary cutter and a cutting board underneath these. Just makes it so much easier than pinning things. And I find when you're using scissors to cut, doing the actions, when you're using scissors to cut pattern pieces, I do find that you're less accurate than using the rotary cutter. So that's a fun thing that I like to use. I tell you what some people do. I think I've seen Tilly in the Buttons. She likes to use like nail varnish, I think she covered hers with, to make them into those little biscuits with the pink icing on. Really cute. I might do that one day. I just, so many things to do, so many crafty things. So that's my gadget for this week. And I hope you guys can get a hold of those washers if you do fancy buying them. I've got 10 that I use at the moment. I think that's pretty good for most things, but I am thinking about getting another set. We'll see whether I get round to it or not. So I've got confessions. I say this every time, that I'm not going to buy any more yarn. I can't help myself. So the last time I showed you some mini skeins that I bought from Fondant Fibre. And I just happened to look on her website again. I saw these. Oh, amazing. So there's a lovely blue and yellow tones. The light isn't brilliant, so it's not looking quite as gorgeous as it is in real life. I don't know whether you can see that a little bit better. It's a bit sort of dark in here, but absolutely beautiful. And there's one with peaches and greens in. There we go. And finally, like a rich purple and this lovely green. See, I love this in combination with the purple. That's beautiful. So this was a little mini skinette selection. I can't think what the name of what it's called. So it's called Covent Garden Skinettes, and I think she's got a few on her website now, so if you want any. And I also bought some more knitter soap. So this is the orchid fragrance, not orchid, orchard fragrance. It is orchard. I bought the tea rose before and I tried it and it's absolutely gorgeous. So I needed to get some of this other flavour just to try out. I think there's another fragrance as well that Deb's got on her website, but if you go and have a look, they're really lovely. I really enjoyed washing my socks in those bars. It just makes it feel a little bit more special. And she put in one of these lovely little lip balms. I've had one of Deb's lip balms before, and this is the vanilla one, the same as I've had. Oh my god, it's gorgeous. I think that's my favourite lip balm ever. So I'm so pleased I've got another one. But guess what? Deb sent one for you guys too. So I've got a whole little set and a lovely little crinkly package. I haven't opened yours. It's all nice and lovely. I'll show you. She sent us basically exactly what I'd ordered again. So there's a lovely bar of soap and that lovely little lip balm. And it comes with a little card with a lovely little stitch marker on there. It's so cute. So there's Deb's card, Fondant Fibre. You can find her on her website. It's absolutely gorgeous. It does say her website name on there. Of course it does. It's her card. So go and have a look and see what she's got. She's got another load of full skeins as well, so go and check her out. So what I'm going to do is use these as a giveaway for the sock challenge. Woohoo! So you could win this whole lovely little set here. Absolutely beautiful. And Deb sent me one of these as well, so I'll put that in with your little prize. So that'd be lovely. So again, don't forget to put your finished objects in the finished objects thread to be legible to win a prize. So you could win one of Deb's lovely skeins. I absolutely love these. So beautiful. I don't know why I feel like I put it on my face. Oh, I'm still got a cold. That's an excuse. I'll just lean right over here to get everything. I've got a different chair today. It's not very matching with my colour scheme. I thought it'd be more cosy as I'm not feeling very well. So I'd looked on Instagram and I can't remember who it was, but they'd bought some mini skeins from this place called Rainbow Cloud. So I went and I started following Rainbow Cloud on Instagram, and then I found her Etsy shop. So it's Rainbow Cloud. Does it say there? It says hand dyed with love. So yeah, if you just put Rainbow Cloud into Etsy, you should be able to find her shop. So I ordered two mini skein sets. Look at those. I have had them out and they're not as neat as they were. So let's go. I tried to put them back as nice and neat as they were to start with. I do apologise. Oh, look at these, they are so cute. We've got lovely little pinks. So this is quite a bright pink. Is that focusing properly? There we go. Nice bright pink. There's a pink with lots of little bits of green in it. There we go. Some pink and a very little tiny bit of green. I think it's green anyway. There we go. Oh, there's lovely little bits of blue in this one. And there's pink and blue in this one. That's lovely. So that's set. If I can read. I Bet It's All About Her, it's called. And there's 5 10-gram mini skeins. And it's a deluxe sock base with 85% superwash merino and 15% nylon. So that's one set. I've made the right mess. At least I tried to get them in there nice and neatly before. So this is out of the second set. Oh, look at that. All different little speckles there with a little green stripe running through. And some lovely pinks again. And these are lovely squishy yarn. It's so nice to have such a variety of colours actually in these mini skein packs. I've got a grey, I'm probably doing this far too quick. You'll have to pause it. I think that's one of my favourites, the grey and the yellow. I don't know why I really like the grey and the yellow together so much. So pretty. There we go. So that's another little mini skein pack. So I bought two, and she so kindly sent me two blue ones to go with it. I think she did have these as sets on her website as well, but I think they've all gone now. I have seen on her Instagram though that she's got loads of other lovely coloured full skeins, so make sure you check that out. I don't know whether they're going to go on Etsy very soon, but they look really pretty. So I definitely recommend Rainbow Cloud as well. I've now got a huge pile of little mini skeins. We are not going to buy any more little skeins. Oh dear. I think that's... Oh, I didn't have another purchase. So I also ordered... I don't know if you've seen these before. Can you read it? They're little Ringos. And this is like a little refill pack that I have. So it's Fripperies and Bibble Bots on Etsy. And I ordered some of these stitch markers before. So these are the... I did order some... These are the extra large ones I ordered. They're not easy to show really, but they're really lovely quality. I got one with all different colours. It might be easier for me to show you in my little pot. There's all different colours. Oh, that's not working, is it? There we go. I've got lots of little different colours. I thought they'd be really nice because sometimes if you're doing a shawl or something, you can sort of get back to that particular colour and you know kind of where you are. I also got some small ones, and these are a gorgeous blue kind of metallic colour. Ooh, egg. Oh, I'll find it later. So they're really nice, just a little lovely little ring with a silver little bead on there. Not the easiest things to show on the podcast, really. But I bought a set of those two. I'm dropping everything today. And I might as well show you this as well. So I went to, I don't know if it was Poundland or Savers or something like that. Nice little cheap shop that sells like soapy things, you know, and washing powders and etc. And it's one of those pill boxes. I think I saw the yarn hoarder had started getting one of these, and I saw this for a pound and I thought, I need one of those. That would organise my stitch markers really well. So they're really good. So I'm glad I bought those. So that's all about my confessions. So they're very useful things that I bought. Oh dear. I had a lovely little yarn swap with the lovely Emma from Eldenwood Crafts. Hi Emma! And she sent me, oh, look at all those little minis. Absolutely beautiful. I'm not going to go through all of them, but what really drew my eye was this one. And I know that Emma knitted some Gryffindor socks, and this must be a little bit of yarn from those. So I'm really excited about using that in my Cozy Memories blanket especially. And there's so many lovely other colours in there as well. You can just about see them. But she's included one of her lovely bags. This is so lovely. So this sort of bluey tealy colour is one of my favourite colours. And it's like a little... I suppose it's sort of between a notions pouch and a small knitting bag. I think I'm going to use it for some little small sock knitting projects that I've got. But I've ordered a bigger one from her shop. You have to be really, really quick because her bags go out really, really quickly. So when she does have an update, make sure you look on the time that it says it's going to be updated, because they literally won't in seconds. So I've ordered a bag, it's a little bit bigger than this, I think it's about this tall, just to have just small projects really, because this is a bit tight for to put like over 100 grams in is a bit tight, but that'll be lovely to put my little bits and bobs in. So lovely, thank you, Emma. And she also gave me a lovely card. It's really pretty. And a cute little notebook. That's really nice. I've been saving this, Emma, so that I don't spoil it before I show it on the podcast. Thank you so much. It was really fun having a bit of a swap. And I also did a swap with a lovely Miriam that contacted me through Ravelry. And she sent me a lovely card with little four-leaf clovers on. That's what they are. I couldn't think for a second. And I'll show you these in my little basket. So she sent me them on cards, which is quite good. Then they don't get tangled at all. And she also sent me this lovely little, if I can pick the right one out from looking at the camera, a lovely little progress keeper there of a little sheep. He's so cute. I don't know if that's focusing properly. Ah, there we go. Lovely, lovely little sheep. I can't wait to use him. I've been keeping him in there so before I could show you, and now I can actually use him. So thank you so much, Miriam. There's loads of little minis there, and between you and Emma, I'm going to be able to do a whole blanket probably with all those little minis. So that's all my swappy things. That was really lovely to be able to swap some minis with people. So lastly, I wanted to show you some of the things I've been making in terms of stationery for the wedding. So I'm sure you want to see this. It's not that interesting. So we've made cute little place cards. I'm just showing you the bride one. Just because I don't want to show you everyone's name. That would be really mean. So we've done on the other side, we've printed the food choices so that people will know what they're actually having to eat. So there we go. And it's got this lovely little edging the same as the invitations that we did, and there's a green one if you wanted to see. And we're also, there is a slight Lord of the Rings theme going throughout the wedding, and we've also called tables different parts of different places in Lord of the Rings. So this is one of the tables, this is the Shire, so these will go on a little clips on a long stand for each of the tables. So we've got the Shire, we've got Fengorn Forest, we've got Rivendell, I can't remember the rest off the top of my head, which was ridiculous really. Oh, Rohan and Gondor and things like that. So really cute things. We haven't finished the table plan yet because I'm not quite sure whether a couple of people are coming, so we're not going to sort it out until those people have confirmed. But we're nearly there, only 12 weeks to go, like, it's crazy. Hello, so finally the Ravelry started to work again, so I can actually answer the questions that I've got up on the Ravelry thread saying ask me anything. So if you've got any questions, go up onto the Ravelry thread, ask me anything, and I'll try and answer in the next podcast. I also write a written answer as well, so you don't have to wait all the time till the next podcast. So Megan7673 on Ravelry was asking me, have I got any recommendations for sewing machines, basically? And it looks like she's not in the UK, so I can't recommend my favourite sort of cheaper machine. Sorry, you can see my laptop reflecting in my glasses. I'm reading this straight from my laptop. I do apologise about that. So she wanted a sewing machine recommendation. So I was saying to her it's best to pick like a good manufacturer of a machine. So I suggested, the machines I have are Pfaff, Juki and Genome. So I think that Genome are normally quite good for quite small machines, so those would be good makes to stick with. Excuse me. But basically, if you just go into a sewing machine shop and just ask them what they recommend, I think that's probably the best idea, because I don't keep up to date with all the models. If you're in the UK, I would recommend one of the John Lewis models, which is £99, I think. Basically, the John Lewis model is the same as a Genome, and you can get the feet, you know, in addition to that, that a Genome make, but actually it's just priced up as or labelled up as a John Lewis. So if you were in the UK, I'd recommend that, but it's just the case of having a look out there and looking at the reviews, really. I'm not very good at knowing all the models, I'm afraid. But I'd suggest if you just stick to a good make, there's lots of good machines out there. So the next question's from Math Marie, and she was wondering if I was able to do any craft at work. And that she said that I've not talked about much about my non-crafting pursuits. And she recognised that I'd worked with Tilly Trout at some point in my past. So Math Marie was saying that she works as a teacher and she doesn't really get chance to knit while she's on like hall duty or anything. So she was wondering how I got time to do it. So my answer is that, so I work as a research scientist. I'm not going to go too much into what my project's all about, just because there's parts that haven't been published yet and it'd just be complicated. So I basically work in a lab and I do experiments with chemicals and cells and things. That's as detailed as I'm going to go into it. But so I get the opportunity in my sort of coffee breaks and lunch times to do a little bit of knitting. I normally knit on a sock in my tea breaks, just so that I can keep it going. But I don't tend to knit in meetings or anything, just because it seems like they take a view as it being a little bit unprofessional. So it's a bit of a shame. It's not fair, is it? I can knit and talk at the same time and think. But I feel as if they look down negatively if I did so. So I don't tend to do that, but in my breaks I do. Let's have a look, see if we've got... I think there's a couple more questions. I had... Laura Lit 4 suggested that I opened a thread talking about wedding things. So if you've got any suggestions or stories about weddings, it'd be great to hear from you. So if you go on to the thread that I've opened up on the Ravelry group, it'd be interesting to see what you've got to say. So I've got one last question from Susan Knitter 2, and she was asking me that with the fish lips kiss heel, she was a little confused about whether to end the lace pattern with the mercury socks on the back of the sock before doing the heel. The pattern for the fish lips kiss says to knit the stockinette stitch for a few rows before doing the heel, and she'd done 10 rows of stockinette, which coincided with two lace pattern repeats on the front. And she says that she thought that the stockinette above the heel was a little too much, and if she made the socks again, she was thinking of starting with 5 rows of stockinette before the heel. And she was asking what I thought. I think this is probably better, because 10 rows is quite a lot. I think 5 rows sounds about right to me, so I think I'd agree with that. And she was also asking that when knitting a fish lips kiss heel with a contrasting colour, do I start with the contrasting colour at the beginning of the heel, or do I knit a few rows of the contrasting colour before starting the fish lips kiss heel? So what I do is I actually start the contrast colour when I'm actually doing the heel. I don't knit any rows of it first, because if you start with the yarn first, you'll end up with a stripe all the way around the foot, which looks nice, I suppose, but I prefer not to have that. So I just literally knit the fish lips kiss heel in the contrast colour and nothing else, if that makes sense. So thank you so much, Susan. Thank you for all your questions. If you've got any more questions, stick those up on the Ask Me Anything thread. I'll be interested to hear what questions you've got to ask. Adam is so sweet. Because of the 1,000 subscribers we got to in the last few days, look what he made me! Oh, you can see my wallpaper reflected in it. So it's a play button that, well, YouTube, when you get 10,000, or I think it's like, no, 100,000 subscribers, I think, you get a gold play button, and he made me a bronze one. How sweet. And he wrote Craft House Magic on it as well, and that's on the glass outside. He's such a sweetie, isn't he? That's everything for today. Thank you so much for joining me, and I hope to see you again soon, and hopefully I won't have a snotty nose and I won't sound strange when I'm talking. Thank you so much. Bye.